That's a trade that we'll watch out for. Dipen Sheth is with us, Head of Institutional Research at HDFC Securities. Dipen, good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us. So, we had a big underperformance compared to global market. We are, you know, sort of ending that over the last 1 month. We've seen big catch up, but still some more left. If you look at year-to-date data, your thoughts on whether we could make some more catch up?
So, a catch up with global markets is one way to interpret this. I think the obvious other way to look at it is to call it the Modi put. And to elaborate on that, I think from the pre-Balakot lows of mid-Feb, we are close to some 10-11% up already in less than, 8 weeks or some such. FPIs have suddenly woken up over the last 2 months. We've seen something like 58 odd thousand crores flowing into Indian equities in the last 10 weeks versus almost zero net, you know, over all of F19. Suddenly, it can't just be a catch-up, right? A lot of things have conspired, if I can call it that way, to convince them to put in this money. And certainly, macros is not one of them. So it's only Modi. And of course, there's catch up to play with global markets because, you know, developed markets have come off 3-4 years of solid outperformance. Bond yields are so low now that you say, okay, there, where's the margin of safety? So let's put some money into emerging markets. So the other emerging markets ran up, but India didn't. Right till the time, there was some kind of feeling that Modi would come back. And I'm not in either camp, but obviously this is the Modi put.
But what about the, you know, things on the ground? I mean, the macro slowdown, will that at some point play a catch up? Or do you think the market will continue to climb all walls of worry?
Yeah, so that's the tricky bit. And also coupled with the fact that what if he doesn't come back? And I'm willing to take both as equal possibilities, even though the markets might be telling me something else as of now. What if macros do not take off? And we know very clearly that Indian macros do take off more in response to global opportunities rather than internal healing. What if Modi doesn't come back? What if the weak view on the monsoons and earnings growth? So again, we postponed earnings growth by a year to FY20. All of this, it also adds up to very low margin of safety here. I'm not playing bear, but I'm just telling you what's there on the other side of the argument.
So are you buyer? That's the.
It's tough to be a buyer except for very, very specific cases here. Okay. And those specific cases do stare out at you pretty strongly. Okay. There are some ground-up, bottom-up stories that need to be bought if you suffer an erosion in market value just because markets drift down. Let's say Modi doesn't come back. Let's say the macros don't pick up. Let's say the monsoon is bad. It's okay because they will eventually get better. These are short-term things that will play out. The longer-term trajectory of India. So whatever happens, Modi is also not going to be able to take it beyond, and this is for the Modi fans, I don't think he can take it sustainably beyond 8.5% on macro growth rate, and the worst of the coalitions can come in and we still won't fall below 6%, I guess. So the longer term story of India is indeed decoupled from its politics, but certainly it helps to understand what margin of safety you have at a broad market level when things get factored in a certain direction.
Okay, so let me straight away come to what you would buy. Now, among the people who haven't participated much in this are auto stocks. Is that your area of interest at all?
No, so that there is some trouble brewing there. We can see that in the very weak numbers over March. And those weak numbers are not just a seasonal phenomenon. In fact, we would have expected March to be very good. The CV numbers obviously ride on two things, which is the IIP cycle, which of course is weak, industrial investment, industrial production, industry and manufacturing as a whole are still very, very weak, and there's no sign that they'll pick up. In fact, we were relying on auto numbers to tell us that manufacturing was strong. And that has evaporated, at least on the CV side. Okay. Then a large story like Maruti, for example. So the discretionary consumption thing has also kind of petered out over a period of time. And what with rural weakness also, and Maruti's 35-40% sales coming from upcountry India. Hero Moto had a disastrous March, and I'm actually expecting significant downgrades for that stock. It remains a value buy. But it's difficult to call out autos as an area of outperformance unless you look for global triggers. And who knows, they might be coming in Tata Motors.
Okay.
Which is kind of gone down to maybe one third of peak price or even lower. And if something big happens, So we want to bring it back under coverage. We kind of lost understanding of it over a period of time, and it just drifted away out of our understanding zone, if I may put it that way. We met them recently, and we suspect that there's a lot of positivity brewing there. A lot of surgical action, if I may call it, that has already played out. And I think the cure should set in, but we'll have to figure out the details of that cure. I'm constructive, but I'm not thumping the table yet on Tata Motors.
Okay, by the way, the market seeing a bit of a, the IT trade getting reversed a bit and banks getting their mojo back. That has happened, of course, over the last few days. Yesterday it started. Wipro is beginning to actually cool off from the high point. Just keep an eye on that. And just keep an eye on Indigo. That's a stock which is once again surging. Crude back to, from high levels, cooled off a bit. That's helping. And in general, issues at Jet Airways leading to this big move in Interglobe Aviation. You have a thought on Interglobe Aviation, Dipen? It's almost getting back to its all-time highs.
Yes, and I must confess that although we were constructive and indeed bullish on Interglobe, the stock has run up way beyond what we might have anticipated. We were cautious simply because the quality of the business, not Interglobe's business, but the quality of the airline business is always suspect in terms of its pricing power and long-term vulnerability to currency, crude prices, and its inability to, price at a premium and offer any differentiated service. It's a commoditized thing. But we were constructive in the sense that here is the best player in the market. Here is the market leader, and he's got a cost structure that is unbeatable, and he standardized his aircraft and all of that. I think the big boost for Indigo or Interglobe, if you may call it that, has been less to do with stable crude prices and good economics in the business. It's been more to do with the fact that a large competitor like Jet is kind of fading away from being a price competitor in the market. So you get naturally high pricing power. Now, if this is changes overnight, if a deep-pocketed buyer emerges for Jet, then what do you think would happen to Indigo? So to that extent, it's at a vulnerable price, but it's a market leader. It's the best run airline in the country, and there is hope that the 110 odd million passenger volume in this country can become 200, 300 over the next 10 years. So to that extent, he's in a growth market. It's not going to, the volume opportunity for him, the addressable opportunity is not going to slow down. And because he's the market leader, I think long-term investors can persist.
All right. Dipen, stay on. At this day, Dipen, what are your thoughts? What would be perhaps the surprise positive performer?
So I hate to agree with Gautam, but I will go out all out here and say that, yes, it's the corporate-focused banks which should see a pop. But I would expect to see shareholder returns and optimism more clearly and emphatically reflected in the way the private pack moves. So remember that there are two large monsters, if you can call them that, in terms of Axis and ICICI, in terms of corporate exposure, who have both gone through CEO changes, who are both arguably at the end of the recognition cycle, and indeed credit costs should begin to fall off. And beyond that, there is also a story of internal healing and change. Dramatic change, market buzz is to be believed, at Axis in particular. Lots of new talent being hired, old talent being fired, and all of that. I think the stuff at ICICI Bank looks less glamorous, but may hold a lot of value also.
I wanted to ask Gautam this.
Before that, on autos, Gautam was making this point about how it will be the most disappointing, not just this quarter, I mean third quarter of a 20% decline is what we've seen in the auto earnings. Right. You think the worst is over, or you'll still get better levels over the next few quarters, you think?
So if you look at the headline prognostications on the monsoon, let us say, on macros, on consumer sentiment, on the rural economy, you should probably wait for a quarter or two. But I'm very delighted and happy, that we are finally beginning to realize that autos is, after all, a cyclical industry. We've had such a long free ride on some of these stocks. We obviously earned our share of unpopularity recently when we released a sell on iShare, for example. We had downgraded Maruti right at the peak to a neutral. And so on and so forth. But I think people need to understand that the auto pack, and indeed the auto ancillary pack, which has got into high teens valuation at the peak of the auto excitement cycle, if I can call it that, this will all come down to ground, and this leads on to great money-making opportunities. I'm actually happy that they're finding their rightful place in the sun. 6 months of disillusionment and another 6 months of business healing, and who knows, we might make serious money all over again in auto, and perhaps led by global names like Tata Motors.
Good investors should like bad news.
Absolutely.
Okay, well,
your thoughts on a stock like Kotak Mahindra Bank, Dipen? You know, it's seen a big move from the recent lows, yes, almost back to its all-time highs.
Yeah, so Kotak has always been very richly valued. I think the disillusionment in terms of what was reflected in the recent underperformance had more to do with corporate issues rather than performance issues related to reducing promoter stake in the bank and the hurdles that it was going through. It is still going through, I dare say, with the RBI. I have a conservative view there, but I think ultimately it's the RBI who gets to decide. And I suppose that they will take an informed and mature decision. Right now, what the market is telling me in terms of the price rebound at Kotak is that things will peter out, and you know, it's all going to end well in good territory. And that's roughly where even I would go. But interestingly, a very well-run, superb metrics bank like Kotak and till a year ago, you know, IndusInd, both of these have delivered like, you know, so IndusInd has hardly moved over the year, and Kotak has been in the mid-teens if you look at, or maybe about 18-19% over FY19. Whereas, if you now look at the next generation of high quality banks in the pipe, so you look at a smaller name like RBL, which delivered something like 35% returns over FY19, almost went under the radar for so many investors who were skeptical about whether they would be able to run a stable show in the midst of all this stress. So the moral of the story is that don't look at the broad picture all the time. Find the gems, find the high quality managements, find the good metrics, and if you pick them early in the game, much like IndusInd, I've seen IndusInd in two digits also, you know, about a decade ago or maybe a little more than that. So RBL, I think, is a 10-year compounder. They've got skin in the game, management has got a stake, fee incomes are good, retailization is happening, that credit card business is running away. You know, I think it's all falling into place, and now they'll raise capital, it'll be book accretive. So again, you will find RBL at an attractive enough valuation.
Yeah, we have to wind up our QS, QT segment.
Final word from your end, Dipen. If you had to give us the Nifty EPS expectation, 646 was what the Kotak said. 603, I think, was you know, Gautam's view for the next year. What's your own view?
I would settle for anything close to 600, but you know, let me lace that with a comment. For
the last 18 times forward.
Yeah, so the last 3 years, I think, Sonia, we have always begun the year with an estimate which got downgraded by up to 20% as the year played out. And the fear that I have this time around is also that the macros and the ability of the companies to post better results, and that too across a diverse set of 50 companies. So maybe Tata Motors will post profits on a very bad base and so on and so forth, or maybe the private sector corporate focused banks will see a pop up in numbers. But there are so many other parts which are moving and which are significant.
Yes.
And with weak macros and a high starting point in the very beginning of the year, you got a 10% trade over March and April already. I think Nifty earnings will get downgraded. That 600 number is also at risk. And I would suspect that somewhere between 550, 570, if it works out, then are you getting into, which is why I began by saying, much as I hate playing the bear, I don't want to be an outright bear here, but there is very little margin of safety. Having said that, find stock-specific ideas to invest. Don't buy the Nifty just like that.
Oh, yes. Thanks a lot, Dipen, for joining us. And Gautam, thanks to you as well.